Okay, I hope everyone can hear me okay. Welcome to this session on Thursday afternoon. Hope you guys didn't eat a very big lunch and are falling asleep, but we promise to keep you quite engaged with this conversation. My name is Moni Basu. I teach journalism at the University of Georgia. I am the director of the MFA program here in narrative nonfiction, which means we don't create anything, we tell the truth. I think it's appropriate that I'm here to have this conversation with Roger Stahl today, since I've been a journalist for 40 years and I have covered the wars in the Middle East as well as in my homeland of India. And before I met Roger a few weeks ago when we first spoke, I had no idea that he was here doing this very important work. And I'm really glad that I've been connected to him in this way. Roger is an author and filmmaker. He's a professor of communication studies here at the University of Georgia. He studies rhetoric, media, and culture, but in large part, his work, I think, has focused on understanding propaganda, public relations, censorship, as they relate to America's war machine, the military machine. He has written several books on this topic and published in various academic journals. I, for one, was enlightened when I watched his latest documentary, Theaters of War, that came out last year in 2022. I had no idea that the DOD complex was so invested in America's film production, Hollywood films. And I'm someone who likes to think of myself as pretty enlightened about these topics, being a journalist. So thank you, Roger, for this important work that you're doing. Roger and his researchers have actually acquired 30,000 pages of internal Department of Defense documents through the Freedom of Information Act. And I can tell you as a journalist, that is no small feat to collect that much documentation. His archival research has found that the Pentagon and the CIA have exercised direct editorial control in over more than 2,500 films and television shows. 2,500. I find that to be highly disturbing. Perhaps most disturbing is that most of us, including myself until recently, didn't know that this was going on. So these discoveries that Roger and his team have made raise important questions about the government's reach at a time when deciphering propaganda from fact has become increasingly difficult. We all know about fake news. So thank you all for joining us again, and I hope you'll find this robust conversation about why the Pentagon wants to be so incredibly involved in America's celluloid adventures to be interesting. Let me start with just listing some of the films that are on your list. Some of them are maybe a little bit obvious, like Top Gun, Zero Dark Thirty, Black Hawk Down. I was more surprised when I saw films like, for instance, the Tuskegee Airmen show up on there, and I want to talk to you about how they got involved with the messaging of that film. And then I even saw Meet the Parents, which I've seen, I think, three or four times on late night TV just for laughs, and had no idea that when we go into Robert De Niro's Mr. Fokker's office there, that the Pentagon had carefully removed a couple of items from his bookshelf. So why don't we start with that? What did they remove from that bookshelf? What did we not see in that character's office? And then maybe we can go into how you got interested in finding this kind of information out.
Well, thank you for a lovely introduction, Moni. And it was great to be paired with you, given your background and kind of bounce some of these ideas off of you. And because you have so much experience in the area of, you know, war making and information warfare and journalism. So it's really a great pairing. I have a rather extensive presentation prepared.
Okay.
So I do want to field your question real quick, because I'm sure whoever's out there is dying to know what does meet the parents have to do with the military industrial complex or the security state. There's a scene, you know, it's all about meeting the parents and being intimidated by them. So the main character, he finds a secret entrance to the basement. Robert De Niro, it turns out to be a CIA agent, and he's looking around and getting increasingly horrified at what he sees, including the lie detectors and other equipment. And, the CIA was consulting in this film, you know, in a kind of light-handed way, because it wasn't necessarily essential for this film to have heavy involvement from the CIA. But they consulted and they asked for the torture manuals, which were scattered all over the desk, to be removed. And these were there for dramatic purposes. And the filmmakers just took them right out. So, you know, you watch that film, you don't get, you know, that little ping of, you know, that visual reminder that the CIA is involved in this. And this was, you know, the year 2000, I think, or 2001, before 9/11. And, you know, they just sort of like airbrushed that little bit out of the film and replace it with pictures of Robert De Niro with dignitaries and presidents and things like that. And, you know, what you saw in the film, you know, I didn't include the backstory of that, which is that, you know, just it was 4 years earlier, 1996, when the Baltimore Sun uncovered, you know, a long history of CIA using training manuals to conduct torture operations, a history that goes all the way back to the 1960s in Vietnam. They published, they got through a FOIA request, they published these training manuals in 1996. So it was proof positive that the CIA was involved in these operations. And so, you know, that was on sort of in the background of how the CIA was thinking about this and how public audiences might approach this film. And they just wanted audiences to forget about it. I will talk about torture as a theme in my presentation. I didn't talk about Meet the Parents, so it's a nice question to kind of start things off on. Should I just dive right in, do you think?
Yes, I would like for you to dive right in, but maybe before you do that, I think it might be useful for our audience to understand the genesis of this project, of your interest in this. How did you get interested in this? Did you stumble upon something that sort of piqued your curiosity, or did you get a tip about it? How did it all start?
Oh, gosh. I've been studying, you know, the military entertainment complex for about 15 years now and writing about it. And there's a small group of scholars out there that do this kind of thing. All of them knew that the Pentagon and CIA had a public affairs office for doing business with the entertainment industries, but nobody had any documents. And we assumed maybe, you know, a couple hundred films, but we didn't know the details. There was a journalistic treatment of this issue in 2004 called Operation Hollywood, which was a really great book done by an industry insider that happened to get its hands, his name was David Robb, on some documentation that really kind of opened the door to this and caught the attention of a lot of academics who had really were in the dark about these operations. And, you know, that was, you know, documents related to only about 3 dozen films. And so we didn't know the numbers, but we started to get a picture of how these operated. And that kind of opened the door to, you know, people doing FOIA requests. And then I got involved in, you know, a couple of Brits who were really heavily invested in, like, prying that door open and doing those requests. So they were putting in hundreds of requests and writing about this. A great resource for this is a website called spyculture.com, which is managed by one of my colleagues, Tom Secker, who whenever he gets a FOIA request, it comes through and there's juicy bits in it. He writes up a little article about it. So you can, if you're curious about any film really in the last 30 years and wondering if the DOD or CIA has had a hand in it, that's a great resource. He makes those primary documents available. But, you know, I was writing about other things and I started to like consult with these two and we were off to the races, and now I'm collaborating with them adding to this huge archive of tens of thousands of documents that you mentioned that we're in the process of collecting.
Okay, great. So with that, if you would like to begin your presentation, I think we have about 45 minutes left, right, for this session. So we should probably get started.
I'll try to leave some time at the end for Q&A because, you know, other people might have burning questions, especially after I provide what I have prepared, which I hope is provocative and entertaining enough. So let me pop up what I have on the screen. Okay, hold on. All right, there he is. Didn't expect that, did you? So Godzilla, Gojira, if you're from Japan. Many of you are familiar with this monster, but probably few of you, unless you're in film and fine arts, know the history of Godzilla. You know, it's pretty widely known that Godzilla as a film franchise has been a kind of thin analogy for nuclear proliferation and the bomb since 1954. This is the first movie. So he rises from the Pacific Ocean, you know, and kind of comes up on the beach and starts destroying cities with his nuclear breath. And there's, you know, the theme of nuclear power and the bomb, Hiroshima, Nagasaki, and also, you know, proliferation has been a part of the Godzilla franchise since the very beginning. And it's a kind of perfunctory for fans, a perfunctory reference point for understanding what this monster is supposed to signify. You know, this monster is the bomb in many ways. And, you know, you can follow this franchise all the way through 1998 when Godzilla takes Manhattan. And, you know, this is where it starts to get interesting from a military support perspective. And that, you know, the producers of this film go to the military and ask for helicopters and ground troops to serve as set pieces for this film. And they have a look at the script and they say, well, you got to change some fundamental things about this story, which is kind of madcap. I mean, it's really about the military going to battle with Godzilla and really losing the fight. And the military didn't like that. They didn't like the fact that in this scene, for example, Godzilla, you know, ducks a few rockets that the military fires and it flattens the Flatiron building behind him, which I think that's a Flatiron building. You know, a couple of different landmarks are get destroyed by the military in their attempt to corral Godzilla in Manhattan, including the Chrysler building. And they didn't like that and they didn't offer support, but the filmmakers kind of charged ahead nonetheless. By the time 2014, There's a representation of the documentation we have on the 1998 Godzilla. So, you know, this is from the Pentagon's weekly reports. So the production company is making this film about this monster, a really nasty giant monster. They want military equipment, personnel, and installations. And the status, as far as this weekly activities entry goes, is we're informally working with the production company to resolve our script concerns, which ultimately weren't resolved, and the military wasn't satisfied and they rejected that one. But as I said, 2014 rolls around and the producers get their act together and their script together, and they approach the DOD and they say, give us everything you have, essentially. So the Navy was heavily involved in this, as you can see, but also the Air Force with a bunch of F-35s. There's tons of ground troops and extras that were used in this, you know, the whole kit and caboodle. And, you know, once again, the script proved to be a little bit of a problem. I'd like to focus on this film just as a kind of way of setting things up and illustrating. They really want all this stuff, including a whole carrier fleet. You know, an aircraft carrier costs about $8 million a day to run. So this is expensive stuff. The military is pretty excited to show off all this stuff, but they want to see the script first. And there are problems in the script. And the first problem is that the main character is sort of this roguish Navy veteran. His name is Ford Brody. And here are the notes that came from the Pentagon to the producers. While Ford may in the end save the day and be reunited with his spouse and son, he is shown on occasion to be exceedingly immature, deceitful, irresponsible, unreliable, and impulsive. He demonstrates no consistent honest loyalty to his family or the Navy. You need to change this. And the filmmakers, of course, they do. If you, this is the filmmaker's response to those discussions and those attempts to change the script. They say, you know, per our discussion, we're going to go ahead and portray Ford as a relatable and capable explosive ordnance disposal lieutenant, whose relationship to Ellie and Sam, his wife and kid, though strained by time away, not because he's a bad dad, is unquestionably loving and likable. So remaking an entire character, you want that if you're running this office. And so you go back to the weekly reports where they're announcing this to the office at the Pentagon. We reviewed the rough cut, which is something they do every time. We reviewed the rough cut with Phil Straub, who's at the time the chief of that office, at Warner Brothers Studios. So they're at the studio. And they have, you know, their initial reaction is really exciting. With excitement, they say, in short, we have a new Navy hero on our hands. This is a successful collaboration for us. We've given them some more notes, some more revisions, but we're moving ahead. And, you know, a couple of other interesting things in these weekly reports. The secretary, which is Secretary of the Navy, so this goes past the public affairs office and all the way up, is very engaged in this process and very excited. And we're even supporting the rollout of this film, which they often do with like red carpet events and military flyovers and all kinds of, you know, premiere stuff. And we're excited to have, you know, the last thing, future projects with the Navy. Maybe the filmmakers will want to do this again sometime. So there's the new Navy hero right there. There are other problems with the script. So as they go through it, not only do they find objections to the main character, they want the military to win. They want the military to win every time and be the heroes. So the reviewer starts counting the number of failed military attacks on these kaiju, these big monsters, and also military casualties. It's looking bad. We're not looking very effective or efficacious. So Apache helicopters go down, F-35s are crashing. By the time you get to the bottom, you know, this reviewer says, I lost count of how many casualties there are. This needs to change. And the producers respond, okay, we're going to instead showcase realistic modern military tactics and weaponry. So the weapons are good, the tactics are good. They're instrumental in saving lives, destroying the creatures. Instead of the monster swiping at pesky Apache helicopters away, it will be successful in diverting them away from civilians. Instead of F-35s crashing and pilots dying, the pilots will parachute to safety because they were prepared for this kind of stuff. So there's a F-35 pilot parachuting in the background in the movie as it was finally produced. Okay. Here's where things start to get interesting. And this is in the production of the image of nuclear power and nuclear weapons. So in the original notes to the producers, you don't find them objecting to this, but it's clear that they did, the military did, because the producers respond to this. So the producers say, per our discussion, here are the revisions that we're going to make to satisfy you people. Rather than portraying a U.S. submarine, in the original script is the USS Michigan, as in the Hawaiian jungle, and there's a scene where they find a nuclear-powered sub in the jungle because one of the monsters who feeds on nuclear power grabbed it and took it into the jungle to feed on the nuclear power reactor that was in the sub. Instead of finding a U.S. submarine in the jungle, we'll switch it to a Russian submarine. So they do that. And this happens over and over, that the U.S. military is, the office is terrified of images of the U.S. military losing control over nuclear weapons and nuclear technology, because the public gets very nervous about this. So you don't want to lose a nuclear sub. That looks bad. So in the end, they replaced it with a Russian sub. Okay. They've got further problems with the script in terms of how it represents nuclear weapons in particular. And this is where it really hits the road. In almost every Godzilla movie, there's a Japanese character. Usually his name is Honda or Sarazawa. But in this one, you know, this the same guy that's playing been playing this character for ages. He says, he tells a story to a military commander about remembering being a boy and listening to his father talk about what it was like to survive himself as a young kid, the bombing of Hiroshima. The military objects to this. They say, you know, if this speech is an apology or questioning the decision to bomb Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that will be a showstopper, i.e. a deal breaker for us. And here's, I thought I had the speech in here somewhere. Well, the speech is really harrowing. It's about, you know, burning flesh and piles of dead bodies and 150,000 people killed. And it's a cinematic description. And the military doesn't like this. So in the final film, the speech is extremely short, and it's about nature finding a way, basically a kind of Jurassic Park narrative. The arrogance of man is thinking nature is in our control and not the other way around, he says. And then that's the end of the speech. So no reference to Hiroshima and Nagasaki in this one. And in fact, there are other shifts in the narrative of this particular film that aren't represented in the documentation, but are really significant when it comes to nukes. The entire storyline is about using nuclear weapons to blow up the monsters. That is, they are a solution to the problem rather than the problem itself, rather than the monster itself. They become the heroes of the film rather than the villains. In the next iteration, the 2019 Godzilla, which wasn't supported by the military, this becomes kind of instituted as a staple storyline, that they use nuclear weapons, underground explosions, to wake up Godzilla so he can fight the good fight, and he's superpowered against the other monsters, and he fights alongside the U.S. military in that task. And you know, I'm not the only one that noticed this reversal when it comes to nuclear weapons and how the Godzilla franchise has handled them. At the time, the Washington Post wrote this opinion article: Godzilla was once a warning against nuclear hubris. Now the franchise is part, Godzilla in the franchise, in the storyline, he's part of the U.S. military. And the nukes are heroes. And that's probably how it will stay. And that's the result of one military intervention into the storyline, a significant one. So now you come out of the theater and, you know, nukes aren't on your mind as a potential threat to humanity. By the way, in place of nukes in this 2019 version, the enemy is eco-terrorists. So they become the main villains. They fill the vacuum. I've kind of approached this presentation in the context of this festival, recognizing that everyone here is a creative, or in the creative industries in some way. And that's how I'm kind of viewing you as the audience. And, you know, this is a story, I suppose, about what it means to be in the entertainment industry and interact with it, but also be subject to the influences that come with, you know, with that are endemic to Hollywood these days. And that includes military and CIA influence. I'll give you a sense of the breadth and the scope of that influence, also the depth of it. As Moni mentioned, I studied war propaganda, and you know, this is material that we just picked up in the last 5 years because we haven't had access to the documents before. So I'm excited to share it with you. But I think this is also, you know, a presentation for creatives. I'm sorry, in addition to the creatives in the audience, just, you know, we as citizens need to know about these forces to sort of interact with the culture industries and interact with geopolitics and the military-industrial complex and its power, and to understand the depth to which it will go to steer public storylines. It's not just coming out of the Oval Office, and it's not just coming from journalism and public relations attempts there, but it's coming from the entertainment industries. And this is new in terms of our level of awareness of it. So I'm calling this presentation The Stealth Occupation of Hollywood. And it's a pretty heavy-handed title. I understand that. but you know, this is a peacetime operation of the entertainment industry. And I use the word stealth, a stealth occupation, because it's largely hidden from public view. And we're just starting to get a sense of how deep this goes. So I'll be talking about the entertainment office today. There's the Pentagon, but on the left-hand side, yeah, this is an office in the Pentagon that's still there. This is the Entertainment Media Office. It was established formally in 1949, but it had been doing business all the way back to 1914, 1915 in less formal ways with the budding film industry. That's obviously Clint Eastwood walking out of there after a negotiation session. And behind him, and I got these from the Baruch Archive in New York City at the Baruch College. Behind him is a guy named Donald Baruch, who is the son of Bernard Baruch, the statesman. But Donald Baruch ran that office from 1949 to 1988. So it's about 30 years, 29 years, a long time. And he was the one who brokered all these deals with Hollywood. That was handed off in 1988 to a guy named Phil Strub, who for 30 years ran it himself. So you have like two very powerful, longstanding personalities who are maintaining relationships, deep relationships often with the industry. So there's Phil Strub on the left on the set of Transformers. And on the right is from an interview we conducted with him at the Pentagon. He was happy to talk with us, which is nice. Very cagey though, very good at his job. Each of the branches of the main Pentagon office, so you had Army, Navy, Marines, and who am I missing? Navy, Marines.
Air Force,
thank you. have offices in or around LA. So everybody except for the Marines has an office in this building, the Oppenheimer Tower, which is right on Wilshire Boulevard, where a lot of PR offices operate. And so it's a stone's throw from Hollywood. And I visited that office during the pandemic when all these offices were actually closed. So I didn't get to knock on any doors. Hopefully I'll be able to visit when they're open. But there they are. There's the Army branch. Those are the first stops if you are a producer wanting to do business with the military. You stop at one of these offices, and that's where your script ends up first before it's cleared at the highest levels in Washington. The CIA opened its own office in 1996. That's very difficult to access, although Trisha Jenkins, who wrote The CIA in Hollywood, did a wonderful job at interviewing all the relevant people and getting a good sense of that operation. So I'm kind of clumping them together in this presentation. What you probably know, if you know anything about these operations, is from the sparse public pronouncements that the DOD has made over the years. They have a webpage. Every once in a while, they do press appearances. It's very rare. But they say, you know, kind of company line, you know, why does the DOD work with Hollywood? Well, it's because they want to accurately depict military stories. Sensible enough. And to make sure sensitive information isn't disclosed. But as I hope to show and have shown, it's much, much more than that. Here are their official directives, what they're supposed to be doing, which you can dig up. Three of them are charged with three things: realistically depicting the DOD, contributing to this murky thing called public understanding, and benefiting recruiting and retention. But they're involved in all kinds of other things, including supporting U.S. foreign policy and justifying all kinds of interventions. I think, you know, I can go over this real quick, the process, you know, the reasons hopefully are obvious to you by now, but it saves filmmakers a lot of money to get their hands on this stuff. So the, you know, the process involves turning over the script in exchange for the stuff. So filmmakers approach the office, they apply, they turn the script, the DoD suggests revisions. Filmmakers either incorporate those revisions or decide not to and go their own way. And they can do that. Nobody's holding a gun to their head. If they go with the DoD, they sign a contract. If the DoD is satisfied ultimately with all the changes and the contract, then they gin up their logistics machine and get the stuff on the ground for shooting, which is a huge deal. The DoD project officer then gets assigned to the set. So there's somebody on set all the time from the DoD to make sure everything is going well, kind of like an executive co-producer. And the DoD gets a final review of the rough cut, as you saw with Godzilla. And they're often involved, as with Godzilla, with a rollout, with the marketing of the film. We didn't, like I said, know about this until the last 5 years of the extent of this kind of activity. We just didn't have the documents, but as Moni referred to, we now have lots of them. That's an older figure, maybe just the FOIA documents would be 30,000, but now with access to archives, you know, we have about 60,000 pages. We're building a large archive that we're going to make public and searchable after I write the book. That shows right now that we can confirm at least 2,500 films and television shows have been subject to contractual relationships, that is direct script oversight and control, since World War II. And that number would probably be a lot higher if we counted individual television shows. So NCIS, for example, it's been the longest running show on TV. The Navy reviews every single script. That number would be about 10,000 if we considered, individual productions within all these series, television series. Here's a list. Oops, supposed to scroll. Oh, there it goes. Beautifully scroll. Selected a kind of a little bit of eye candy for you. Things that have been produced in the last decade or so, two decades. You remember in that Godzilla script review notes, they mentioned the word showstoppers. These are the deal breakers. And I want to give you a list of what those are because patterns developed after we had a look at these documents of things that the military really wants to expunge from the scripts. And they include internal problems to the institution. So drug and alcohol abuse, suicide, PTSD, the long-running sexual assault problem, racism, anything that has to do with the privatization of the military or influence of oil companies, wasting public money. There's also, as Godzilla kind of illustrated, they want to get rid of anything that shows that the military is incompetent. So losing control of the nukes, losing wars, reference to, you know, the fact that the United States lost the Vietnam War, was taken out of a Bond film at one point. I think that was a Living Daylights. Equipment malfunctioning, things going wrong, friendly fire, accidentally shooting one's own troops. Crimes, war crimes, torture, assassination, overthrowing foreign governments, banned weapons, depleted uranium, white phosphorus, you name it, Agent Orange. Drug trafficking, as in, you know, what the CIA did in the Iran-Contra affair. Arms trafficking, none of that works for them, and that will be a deal breaker. So these are the kinds of things that are systematically scrubbed from scripts. So the question arises, you know, can the DoD stop a film from being made if they want to? And the technical answer is no, they cannot. But it's really hard to make a film, much harder, if you don't have the DoD support, and it's particularly the case with films that heavily rely on DoD storylines. So on the left and on left of Tom, to the right of Tom Cruise, I guess, but also on the right, there's Jerry Bruckheimer, who produced Top Gun. And he said, that Top Gun just simply wouldn't have been made without DoD help. And there he is on the set of Pearl Harbor too. And he said the same thing about that. We just wouldn't have these films. Mace Neufeld said the same thing about The Hunt for Red October. He's the producer behind the whole Jack Ryan series, from Hunt for Red October through Patriot Games to The Sum of All Fears to the new Jack Ryan series on Amazon. And, you know, he went to to Paramount, to the CEO, Ned Tannen of Paramount. He said, I want to make this film based on The Hunt for Red October novel by Tom Clancy. And the first question was, well, will the DoD support it? And he says, I think so. And I think I can do this movie for $15 million. He said, okay, I'll give you $15 million. If you get DoD support, we'll sign this film. We'll green light it. And if you don't get DoD support, then we won't do it. And I'm going to put that in your contract. This is a story that Mace Neufeld told at the Naval Academy to people who are interested in the history of submarines. You know, that's a film that just was contractually would not have been made without DoD support. And the rest of the Jack Ryan series too, probably excluding the one film that was made without DoD and CIA support. You know, the rest were. It's heavy involvement in that series. There was another one that you haven't heard of because it wasn't made, called Countermeasures, which is an interesting case. This was a kind of retelling, a fictional retelling of Iran-Contra, a weapon smuggling ring on an aircraft carrier. And as you can imagine, when they brought that script to the White House, to the DOD office, they didn't like it very much. And they said, you know, even though you got Sigourney Weaver on board, and even though Touchstone is full steam ahead with this picture, there's no reason, they said, for us to denigrate the White House or remind the public of the Iran-Contra affair. And that was enough to sink this film. No aircraft carrier, no film. They dropped it, and nobody was reminded again in 1991 of the Iran-Contra affair. I interviewed Oliver Stone in his home a couple of years ago about Platoon and Born on the 4th of July. And these are films that both went to the DoD, both were denied, and they just sat on the shelf, and he figured they were dead projects for the longest time. He's a bulldog and pursued it, and on a shoestring got Platoon made, but it was hard. He had to go to the Philippine government for old Bell helicopters in order to make that film. There's one called Fields of Fire, which is interesting as well, based on a book that's assigned reading for military officers, for Marine officers. So the military has vetted this one, and it was written by the former Secretary of the Navy. His name is Jim Webb. He's a decorated Vietnam Marine veteran. And he wrote a screenplay based on his experience in Vietnam, and it looked a lot like Platoon, actually. And the DoD said, no, this has got drugs. It's got execution of civilians, burning villages, all the kinds of things that went on in Vietnam that they don't want to talk about. And so we're not going to support it. And that film was never made. Jim Webb was not happy about that. He wrote a very nasty letter to the Pentagon about their propagandistic operation. Here's a list of films that were denied and never made, in case you're interested, which outnumbers the number of films that were approved and never made by at least a factor of 2 to 1. So that gives you some sense of how powerful a denial can be in the industry. The DoD, and I'm trying to really buzz through this because of time. I want to leave some question and answer time. But the DoD is not only interested in getting rid of things, they're also pushing things. So they want to sell the public on weapons systems. So there's Man of Steel, which is the Superman movie in 2016, which was the silver screen debut of the F-35, which some of you know is the biggest boondoggle in military history. $1.5 trillion spent on that program, and they barely fly. They're still blowing up when they get hit by lightning. There's huge problems with the F-35, and nobody in the military really seems to like them. They're not very useful, but they want to sell the public on them and quell the controversy. So this is about developing emotional attachments to the F-35. So they start plugging it into films by name. as they're going through the script review process. Same with the Navy and what they call the littoral combat ship, which is pictured below, that was plugged into Jack Ryan and a number of other things. It's kind of the F-35 for the Navy. It's not very useful. It's also controversial. But they're plugging weapons all the time. They want to showcase them. The example of Iron Man is a really dramatic example of this, because this film was chock full of military equipment, just brimming. The original script wouldn't allow for that kind of thing, though, because in the original script, Tony Stark, who is Iron Man, is this inventor who basically goes to battle against the military industrial complex. His dad is a weapons manufacturer, and his dad is stealing his ideas and turning them into weapons. And so he dons the Iron Man suit and goes to battle against these weapons manufacturers. I mean, literally goes to battle against them and ends up in a fight with his own father, and wins in the end. They had to get rid of the entire script as they went into negotiations with the DOD. And so Tony Stark, if you've seen this movie, ends up as this celebrity weapons manufacturer who inherits very happily his father's business. And that kind of clears the way for F-22s and B-2 bombers and all kinds of stuff that shows up in that film. It's a dramatic example of how, just the need to showcase weapons changes the entire storyline. I mean, Tony Stark as Iron Man is fighting insurgents in Afghanistan by the time the whole thing is done. The military is also interested in boosting the sense that military solutions work. Let's see. So they don't want to be seen as cowards, or they don't want to be seen as having failed in their duty. We saw this with Godzilla, but there's a funny example from War of the Worlds with Tom Cruise. This is, coming back from the DOD after their script reviews, page 93, Marines don't retreat from the aliens. We conduct a fighting tactical withdrawal instead. So please put that in the script. They're also interested in rehabilitating failed missions. The best example of that is Black Hawk Down, which, involved the State Department and the Secretary of Defense and negotiations with the Kingdom of Jordan to get access to that country for filming it, and also a status of forces agreement so they could put military hardware on Jordanian soil. 100 military extras, something like 25 helicopters of different kinds were used for this film. I mean, it was just complete, utter cooperation from start to finish. And, it completely changed the American memory of Mogadishu, which was for about a decade seen as an abject failure on the part of the U.S. military and slaughter of civilians. And now we see it as a successful rescue story. And that kind of set the stage for doing this over and over. A reality show on National Geographic Channel called Inside Combat Rescue, heavy involvement. It's also a bunch of rescues. The Long Road Home, another rescue from the Iraq War, of a really kind of embarrassing episode of an ambush. Argo for the CIA, it was about the Iran hostage crisis, was a black eye on the CIA for 30 or 40 years. And rescued by Argo, which is, the story of the rescue of six of the 55 Americans who were held hostage there. The rest of them were held, for 444 days, but the six got out. That was heavily supported by the CIA from start to finish. And there's a bunch of other rescue movies that are coming out in the wake of Afghanistan and Iraq. So you have Kandahar, one called The Interpreter, and Jake Gyllenhaal on the right. This one's called The Covenant. These are, we can't confirm right now that these are military supported. They might not all be, but we have strong indications that they are at this point, and we're doing the FOIA requests as we speak. on these films. But this is what happens. It happened at the end of Vietnam. You have all these rescue scenarios that come to the rescue, that are designed to rescue the history of these failed military ventures and turn them into something of a success story. You know, the memory of Afghanistan is kind of this festering wound for Americans, a psychological wound, you might say. I mean, it's quite another thing for Afghanis. Hollywood to the rescue, and the DOD to the rescue of Hollywood. I have about 10 minutes left, but I'll just say that there's all kinds of attempts to scrub war crimes from the screen as well. I mean, they tried to do it with Platoon. They did it with the Navy SEALs, you know, no executing prisoners, no executing the wounded. They took that out of the script. They tried to do it with Heartbreak Ridge, but Clint Eastwood said, I'm going to execute prisoners anyway, and I don't need your help. He did it his own way. For rules of engagement, there was an execution and it was supported, but the military made sure that this execution was fully justified, that there are American lives on the line before you shoot a prisoner. So this one of the prisoners is shot in front of another one so that the other prisoner tells about an ambush that is imminent, an imminent threat to our troops. So they were able to massage this one to justify an execution. And of course, you know, justification of torture, as we mentioned before, starts to be the way that the CIA does business too after 9/11. So there's all kinds of justification of torture activities, ticking time bombs and things like that in 24, which was CIA supported, and Zero Dark 30, you know, supposedly how we found Osama bin Laden was through information garnered through torture, which is not the case, but was the CIA-supported story nonetheless. I'm just going to buzz through, you know, think about Top Gun Maverick as a war crime, too. He's attacking a sovereign country, which is unnamed. You know, think about if, say, Iran or China made a movie about their fighter jets bombing a nuclear installation, a military installation in the United States with government support. How would we view that movie? Probably as naked propaganda and probably as justifying and encouraging war crimes. But of course, we're so used to that, that those questions never arise when you and I go to Top Gun Maverick. So what's the point of all of this? If you're a creative person and you're in these industries, I hope that some of this information, as it leaks out, puts you in a position where you can put pressure on the industry to resist attempts, even though, you know, there's a juicy carrot being dangled in front of the producers. Resist attempts to control the narrative through these expensive exchanges with the military. And maybe at some point it will become a badge of honor and something worth broadcasting as part of, you know, the rollout of a film, that it was produced without help from the CIA and the Pentagon, and tells a story nonetheless, an independent story. I wrote an op-ed for the LA Times that made this case, and hopefully we can all take that seriously. And, you know, I decided to plug my own film. If you want to know more about this, you can check out Theaters of War. It's streaming on Canopy. I can probably get you a bootleg copy. But we're working through a gigantic grant right now to get it on big commercial streaming platforms and on TV. So it'll probably come your direction or be available at some point. Also, you know, we might think about pressuring our government to have a disclosure notice at the beginning of films and television that upfront tells people that these were subjected to these kinds of deals. And I think that could go a long way in informing the public, who have simply no idea now which films are supported and which are not. So I hopefully this very brief presentation alerted you to the existence of what I call a security state cinematic universe, and arms you with some tools for engaging it, and perhaps if you're in the right position of power, resisting it at some point. So thank you so much for muscling through this presentation. It's glad I'm thrilled to be sitting in front of you and talking about these things, which are very exciting to me. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Roger, for that really insightful presentation. We've got a few minutes left. I just want to start off the Q&A. We have a couple of questions here in the chat, but I want to start off by saying you just finished talking about why do they do this? What's the point of it? Has there been any kind of qualitative research done that sort of shows how these movies, these films, television shows are actually affecting the American mindset?
I can point to a couple of studies of video games, like laboratory studies of video games that were supported by the DoD. So Call of Duty, Medal of Honor, these are longstanding franchises and extremely popular war games. That have received consistent DoD help. Some studies show that there are big effects and some studies show that there are not, depending on what questions they ask. I'm not aware of qualitative studies or quantitative studies regarding exposure to films and the effects of those. That would be, cultivation theory and the Cultural Indicators Project, they would do work like that. But I'm pretty sure that they have not, mm-hmm. or else I would have run into it. Yeah.
I'm just thinking about, like when the Iraq War started, for instance, I know a lot of Americans saw it as, oh, this looks like the video game that I play when the carpet bombing of Baghdad started. So I wonder if these films somehow, obviously they're designed to prepare us more for accepting, as you said, foreign policy decisions or accepting certain aspects of military culture, that it's okay to do a lot of these things.
I would expect, there's been work on torture. I don't know if laboratory work has been done on torture and exposure to films like 24 and Zero Dark 30. That would be an easy place to go to see if those, pretty bold-faced arguments made it through and if they affected people's view of that particular controversy. This work is just beginning, and it's beginning on the desks of people who work in the humanities more than in the social sciences.
Mm-hmm. I think there was a question in the chat that referred to or was asking, how is what the DoD, what they're doing with films, how is that different than, say, product placement in movies and television shows by big multinational corporations? Or is it the same sort of thing that we're seeing here?
It is more formalized. If you're going to support an episode of Friends and put a can of Coke on the table or something like that, you're going to want to see the entire script so that they don't denigrate soda pop or something. it's very much like that kind of process. And certainly the showcasing of weapons is a form of product placement, straight up. They are much more interested in ideological components, much more interested in historical representations than, your average corporate product placer might be. The range of things that they are paying attention to is much, it has a greater purchase on our ability to act as citizens in a democratic society.
Mm-hmm. Okay, maybe time for one more question from the chat. This person is asking, do you have a sense of how far back the DoD's historical concerns go? You stated, I think, that the office was created in the 1940s, but this question is pertaining to how far back does do the concerns actually go? Vietnam is clearly a touchy subject. But what about the Korean War, or the Spanish-American War at the end of the 19th century, or even the War of 1812?
I would say World War II is about as far back as it goes. There's not, you know, Korean War is the forgotten war. There's not a lot of movies made about it anyway. Incheon would be a good example of that that came out in the early 80s. But that, of course, that was more commentary or affecting Americans and their view of Vietnam than it was Korea. You know, Korea is a stand-in, kind of like MASH for Vietnam. But I would say World War II is about as far as it goes back. And I can't think of any examples that are, say, commentary on World War I or the interwar period that really have any teeth. Yeah. You know, a lot of the commentary is about Vietnam, as the person who asked the question pointed out.
And now I'm assuming they will be about Iraq and Afghanistan as well. Two more botched wars. Mm-hmm. Okay, I think we're near time, but let me just close by asking you this question. So you've done all this incredible research. What surprised you, or were you surprised by any of your findings? And what was your takeaway? What is your takeaway from all of this?
I'm surprised every day by this stuff, because, you know, it's a lot of documentation to go through, and, you know, I'm still kind of wading through it. And I find little weird aspects of this story. You know, the first thing that surprised me, you look through the weekly reports, which I wish I could just put on the screen and scroll right through, you know, what are they working on in 2018? Now, let me show you. And you would think, you know, it's a bunch of Hollywood feature films, but it's only about 20%. And the rest of it is like, okay, we're going to do a flyover on this stadium. We're going to appear on the Ellen DeGeneres show here. Dude Perfect is going to do a thing on an aircraft carrier on this, you know, web-based show. It's a lot of reality TV and game show stuff, you know, like The Price is Right and military shout outs here and there and reunions of different kinds. So that's what surprised me the most. It's like, okay, how many cake shows are they involved in? How many cooking shows are they doing? So I'm expecting to be like a scholar of war film, and that's not really where they're putting all of their energy. They're fanning out into reality TV land and also influencer territory. So you'd be surprised. We start off in Hollywood and we end up, you know, in these seemingly insignificant but high, ubiquitous and distributed projects throughout, you know, these other platforms.
Well, I don't think I'm going to be able to sit through a movie the same way ever again, knowing what I know now. And I'm just very curious about how exactly this affects the American psyche and how much, how deeply entrenched all of this is. Because I think, you know, it is, a lot of these films end up being propaganda almost. I mean, I don't know if you want to go there and call it that name, use that word propaganda, but I think of like different countries that I know of, more autocratic countries than ours, that put out films like this as propaganda. And I think what you suggested earlier, maybe we should be labeling these films as such, that the DOD has had an input in it, is probably a wise move to warn audiences.
Yeah, thank you. You can use, I use the word propaganda, but very carefully. It's a touchy one.
It's a touchy one. All right. Well, I think we're out of time with that one, unless anyone in the audience has a burning question for Roger. One last chance, raise your hand or in the chat.
It's your chance to really nail me.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for this great presentation and for your insights today.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you for hosting this. Thanks for coming too, everyone. Great to see your names.